Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining us here at Ministries of Hope Christian Church for our Bible studies. We are in the book of 1 Kings, and we are diving into it, learning more and more out of it. So grab your pen, grab your pencil, grab your paper, grab your book so you can take notes and you can understand what God has in store for you. Before we do so, let us go to God in prayer. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you, Lord God, for taking us here one more time, diving into your word, getting what you say, Lord God, armoring up, Lord God, so that when we are faced with the attack of the devil, we can go back to these instances. We can draw from your word, we can draw the strength of the Lord, and we have what to stand on, because the same God that they're serving is the same God you are today. So I thank you, Lord God, for opening up our eyes and our understanding so that you can bless us with your word. Bless those who are listening to us, bless those who are hearing us, and I'm asking you, Lord God, to move in their lives in a mighty way. Thank you, Lord, and we go to you, to go to your word, Lord God, and seek and find. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Over to you, Reverend Thompson.
Thank you, Reverend Hutchings. Amen. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. We're going to continue running today with 1 Kings chapter 20. Picking up at verse 13, as you turn there, just a quick recap. We saw where Benhadad came to Ahab, letting him know what his requests were and demands. Ahab has turned it down, and now we see the war is about to begin. So we're going to continue running in that vein. Pastor, is there anything else you want to add?
No, just follow the word. That's all.
Amen. Amen. So we're picking up at 1 Kings chapter 20, verse 13. Brother Thompson, we'll start off with you. As always, we're reading out of the King James Version unless we otherwise state.
Amen, amen. Verse 13. And behold, there came a prophet unto Ahab, king of Israel, saying, thus saith the Lord, hast thou seen all this great multitude? Behold, I will deliver it unto thine hand this day, and thou shalt know that I am the Lord.
Amen. All right, let's just stop right there. Yeah, the title of this is Israel will be victorious. And what did we say? If God is not in it, you can't win it. But we see from the start here, it says, behold, there came a prophet unto Ahab, the king of Israel. Now, we know that Ahab hasn't always been in good standing. But what does the Bible say in Romans 8:28? All things work together for the good. Amen. All things, whether it's good, bad, evil, whatever. God can turn around and work it for good. Mm-hmm. And it says, thus saith the Lord, hath thou seen all this great multitude? Behold, I will deliver it into thy hands this day. And thus shall know, thou shalt know that I am the Lord. In other words, now, you've done what you can do. You're scared. You're frightened. Mm-hmm. And God knew he was right, because mm-hmm. here come all of these kings and their countries and whatever up against him. But God said, what he said, behold, mm-hmm. here comes the prophet from the Lord. And mm-hmm. God said, I will deliver them into your hand. How many times have we seen since we've been in this Bible here, when God sends his people in, he's sending them in to get the job yeah. done the right way.
Mm-hmm. Right. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, while you're talking, this made me think that, you know, this is the best time for God to step in. And, you know, as I was, you know, I said before that, you know, this, as we're going through the Bible, there's a lot of examples and testimony that we can sort of lean to, you know, showing us who God really is. And as I was saying, this is a perfect example, because when you would think all the odds are stacked against you, God can, you know, as we always say, nothing's impossible for God.
Mm-hmm.
We step in when you think it's, you know, possibly think it's impossible, because it's, as he stated, like 32 kings that we had mentioned before we were mm-hmm. together, that, mm-hmm. you know, you think about 32 kings and coming up against
all these people. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That, mm-hmm. What will I do, or what can I do? But as you know, just go to God and he'll handle
it. You can make a way out of no way where you can't see that, but oh, that's no hidden call, though. God sent. Sometimes we have to call, but when God sees what's going on, he will send somebody. He sent Nathan to David. It was a whole different situation, but he sent them David. And now unto Ahab, who is not a perfect man. I didn't get down here to see who it was, but go ahead.
What stands out to me is that even no matter what Israel has done, God will never go back on his promise. He promised to be with them, and he's always going to be with them. And now that he saw that they needed him, even though they didn't call him, he's not going to let these kings come in and take over his people when he did not ordain them to be under these kings. He didn't say that they could put them in captivity. Sometimes he'll allow them to go into captivity to teach them a lesson. But it wasn't his will for them to be captured by these 30 whatever kings. So it's not going to happen. You know, so when you are a child of God, what God has for your life, you got to stand on the promises of God, because no matter how the situation look, God says it's not going to happen, it's not going to happen. You know, they come in big and bold and, oh, we don't, but even though Ahab wasn't fully, you know, 100% under God, he's kind of wishy-washy or whatever, God can use anything. God used the donkey to talk. He can use anything. So he used the fact that, you know, Ahab was willing to stand up for the children of Israel after, you know, he almost backed down. He used that. The word of God says he can make he says all things work together for the good of those who love the Lord and are called according.
I left that part off because Ahab wasn't loving the Lord.
I know.
But yes. He will turn anything that he wants, I don't care if it's evil or what, he will turn it around and work it out for me.
He's working it out. What stuck out right there in verse 13 was a reference for, I will deliver it into thine hand this day. Verse 28. I was trying to find where it was behind there, but in verse 28 it says, and there came a man of God and spake unto the king of Israel and said, thus saith the Lord, because the Syrians have said, the Lord is God of the hills, but he is not the God of the valleys. Therefore will I deliver all this great multitude into thine hand, and ye shall know that I am the Lord. So it shows, you know, God is honoring his name, and through them, he is working to show that he's the God to all of them, because, you know, it just shows God controls it all. But I love it where, okay, you going to say that I'm just the God of the hills and I'm not God of all. I'm going to show you I'm the God of all. Here come these 32 kings that is coming up against them. And by man's standards, it looked like there's no way to win. But as we were saying at the top of this conversation, when God is in it, there's none but victory to be had, because he's going to work it out for your good every single time. And to man's standards, it could look like you losing, but in the end, God is still, you're going to win if God says it and it's so. And I like that right there, because God don't forget nothing, okay? Which is a good thing and it's a bad thing, you know, because at the same time, it's like, Lord, forget our sins, Jesus. But that's why we got Jesus in the way. But you see this where he is saying, because they said, the Syrians have said that the Lord God of the hills, he's using them to punish them in the same token, you know? And so when you're out here with the name of the Lord, sometimes he will use you in order to fulfill, get his will done, you know, you're a willing vessel. And they because as Reverend Hutchings was saying, because he has made that covenant vow back with Abraham, we first got this started, that he was never going to leave them people. Mm-hmm. We see God is working it out, even in their disobedience. And that's why we cry to the Lord during testimonies and stuff like that today and now, because he's the same God. Because even though we don't deserve his grace sometimes, he still is gracious to us. He's still merciful to us. You know, David put it best in Psalms, you know, that
who are we that he is mindful of us? Mm-hmm. You know, because he just is. He's just a good guy. That's why he's so good, because we know it's nothing that we've done in and our of ourselves why we reap the benefits of God's blessings sometimes, mm-hmm. even though we don't deserve it. Because by man's, they don't deserve it. Look at Ahab. You know, he done tried to usher in a whole new religion. We done seen all this going on with him and Jezebel, mm-hmm. and God is still holding true to that covenant.
All things work together for the good.
Come on.
And, yeah. and again, this is a perfect, this atmosphere is a perfect atmosphere for God to show that he's God.
Yeah.
All by himself. Because just like he cut down the army and only bring 300 to the battle, just like how when he allowed them to walk around the walls of Jericho and just shout, it's like, look at the amount of military these other 30, how much people have. And he's going to take Ahab's little military and conquer all of that.
Mm-hmm.
Just to show that he's God all by himself. And look, don't play with him, because he's going to cover you, whether as long as you are considered a child of God. You know, I mean, you all you gotta do is trust in God and stand on his word and stand on his promises. Ahab knew that he could, because he done burn up the altar with all the sacrifice and everything, and show out right there for Elijah. Ahab knew that God could.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay, let's go ahead to 14 and see what else we got down here.
Amen. Verse 14. And Ahab said, "By whom?" And he said, "Thus saith the Lord, even by the young men of the princes of the provinces." And he said, "Who shall order the battle?" And he said, "Answered, thou." Then he numbered
that,
the
right,
young
men. That tells you a lot right there.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
Ahab is still kind of doubtful. What did he say, by whom?
Mm-hmm.
And he's talking to this prophet. And he said, "Thus saith the Lord, even by the young princes." And we know those are young fighters too. So he still had a little, Ahab still had a little doubt there.
Mm-hmm.
And then Ahab probably wanted to know who it was that was going to do all of this. Mm-hmm. So he could still get the glory.
Mm-hmm. I like that answer too. Ahab said, "By whom?" And he said, "Thus saith the Lord." That's all you need. No, God
right.
said it.
That's right.
Right. Man. Look, it's just, ooh. It's just interesting, because even with Ahab.
Okay, let's go to 15, because this gets interesting down here. 15.
Yeah,
he numbered.
Amen. Verse 15. Then he numbered the young men of the princes of the provinces, and they were 232. And after them he numbered all the people, even all the children of Israel, being 7,000.
Mm-hmm.
Going on to 16.
Mm-hmm.
And they went out at noon, but Ben-Hadad was drinking himself drunk in the pavilions, he and the kings, the 32 kings that helped him.
All right, right there. Okay. Now, they numbered the people that they had, all told 7,000?
Mm-hmm.
Ben-Hadad was what do you see? He was overconfident.
Mm-hmm.
They had it made, so he didn't have to worry about anything else. So they're getting high and being merry. When it says drunk, drinking himself drunk. And even the kings that was with him was helping him to drink and be drunk. They were all partying and having a good time, because they figured this battle is won already. This is a piece of cake. We're going to go in here and wipe them out and keep on moving.
Mm-hmm.
But you don't underestimate the Lord.
Amen.
I don't care what false prophets you have around you that's telling you certain things. You better make sure that it lines up with the word of God.
Mm-hmm.
Because as I said, you can see on television nowadays, there are a lot of people putting out some bad stuff out there. You best to get in your word and see what thus says the Lord.
Amen.
What did this guy, the prophet, said? Thus says the Lord. The Lord said it. So what we have to do is go back whenever we are told things by... A lot of people attend the big churches because they like the atmosphere of the big churches. They like to be seen in the big churches. So whatever's going on and said and done in there, then they're going to adhere to that. But what you better be sticking to is what comes out of these 66 books.
Amen.
Okay. Well, just like you said before, I'm not sure where it's from, but even though you can attest that, just as you were saying today, you never know who you may come up against. As you said, you never want to go against God's anointed.
Right.
So these kings and, you know, these 32 kings and Abinadab, you know, just me thinking they may not have heard. They may not have heard, you know, who Israel's God was. So they're going against one of God's anointed.
I don't know if Ahab was really anointed or not.
Okay.
We're talking about Ahab now. Ahab didn't try to get holy to the end there. But we read someplace in our study here recently that there were so many people behind the scene that was still, you remember that, still Christian? That the top front people didn't know that they were anchored in the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
So what do we always say? God has a remnant.
A remnant, yeah.
Okay. And go back to Moses. He had a ram in the bush. God's going to have a ram in the bush that's going to stand for righteousness.
Yeah.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Reminds me of Abraham too, where he said, if there be one, will you destroy the city? If there, you know, and he's like, no, if he finds one. So that's just interesting. What it reminds me of is 1 Peter, where it says, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion walking around, seeketh whom he may devour, whom resists steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world. Mm-hmm. And so looking at him being drunkard, you know, we can't just be drunk off of what people say and how they tickle the ears. You know, we can drink in what folks say a lot of times because it may seem like it sounds right. But as Pastor was just saying, that's what it reminded me of. Just saying, when we go back and look at this word, you know, you got to line it up to make sure that it's true so that you're not fooled by what you're hearing, as long as it lines up with the word, you know, because faith comes by hearing, and hearing comes by the word of God. It doesn't come by the mouth of people. It comes by the word of God. Mm-hmm. So they got to be speaking God's words. And we can do that and sit there and not be sober minded and be vigilant, you know, and by that be seduced, especially in this day and age with all the crazy that's around us. And everybody calls themselves a prophet and an evangelist and a preacher and a teacher and a lawyer and a judge and all of the above. But check them credentials. Is it lining up with the word of God?
Mm-hmm.
You know.
Abinadab thought he had time. You know, he was overconfident that, you know, he had the time, he had the men, he had the power, he had everything together. So he thought he had time. So he was like, you know, not nonchalant, not even, you know, giving attention to that they're coming. So it's like us today when we're sold out in our sin. We know about God, we hear about God, we know he's coming, but we think we have time. We think we have time to turn it around and get it right.
Really, a lot of people don't believe today then.
Mm-mm. Yeah.
A lot of people, young people, old people, a lot of old people, they don't believe. And don't let someone get insulted in church, then they turn away from God and everything else.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And then you have those that grew up in church and went away to go do the other life and think they got, you know, time to do what they got to do out there and come back and end up losing their life out there before they have a chance to come back.
Well, you're going to get off my toes today, okay? Because... I was like, I put my finger up, Lord, give me a minute. I'll be right back.
That's why I pray. That's why I love him like I do, because I'm like, thank God you didn't let me go in my foolishness.
Likewise, when God gets through with me, I'll come forth like pure gold.
Good. I think all of us did it.
I'm going to use that from now on.
But it just goes to show, if we but just knew who we were really truly playing with. You know, and knew the word like we're studying it now, there's a whole lot of decisions that I made back then when I was young that I wouldn't have made. I would have been.
We're going to do it. A lot of the kids have been raised up under the word, and they get sick of it.
Yeah.
They want to see what's out there. And they leave their, a lot of preachers' kids and homes that are truly, you say, where God is being in the home. They get sick and tired of that. They see their friends out there doing things differently. So they are going to do it too. And the only thing we as parents can do is pray. Just pray that before something happens, that they return.
This encourages me, though. Looking at that same token, I just saw something different. Just the fact that because he thought he was, Benadad saw that they were going through this famine, so stuff was weak, and he thought this was the perfect time to get everybody against them to attack. But it shows that even in our weakness, God is strong. Amen. And I like how Paul says it, you know, if it causes for me to be weak in order for me to have God's strength, you know, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, then let that be it. Let me be as weak as they come because I got God's strength. And I like that even in the weakness, God is still there protecting all sides. You know, he says he doesn't sleep nor slumber. And I love that because it gives encouragement to know that you may be sleeping, you may slumber sometimes. You know, we're all not going to get it perfect all the time, but our God is perfect, who we serve is perfect, and he going to get it right all the time, and he's there covering and watching your back. And I love that because in this day and age, like, the God before you, who can be against you?
Amen.
And most of the time, we're our own worst enemies.
Yeah, exactly.
Most of the times, I think all the time.
We're in our head too much. We want to make our own decisions, and God is just saying, let me take the reins and walk the way I tell you to go.
We do what we think is right in our own eyes.
And walk over every landmine that's in the field.
In the field, and get blown up, and then say, well, I'm a Christian.
Why didn't you have it? Why didn't you tell me that was there, guys? I told you. I told you go left. You chose right.
Okay, let's go on and see what I said here.
Amen. We're in verse 17. They were in 1 Kings chapter 20 at verse 17. The word reads, and the young men of the princes of the provinces went out first, and Ben-Hadad sent out, and they told him, saying, there are men come out of Samaria. And he said, whether they be come out for peace, take them alive, or whether they be come out for war, take them alive. For these young men of the princes of the provinces came out of the city and the army which followed them. And they slew every one his man, and the Syrians fled, and Israel pursued them. And Ben-Hadad, the king of Syria, escaped on a horse with the horsemen. And the king of Israel went out and smote the horses and chariots and slew the Syrians with a great slaughter. And the prophet came to the king of Israel and said to him, go strengthen thyself and mark and see what thou doest. For at the return of the year, the king of Syria will come up against thee.
What did he say down the last part of that? Go strengthen, in other words, build up your strength. Go strengthen thyself and mark this day down and see what you're doing. For at the return of the year, the king of Syria, in other words, get yourself together because he'll be back.
Mm-hmm.
He'll be back.
Read the commentary I have, start for 13 through 16. where it says, since there is no mention of Israelite chariots, Ahab's chariot army may have been disabled by the drought. A surprise attack by provincial infantry bought victory for Ahab's army. God's intervention helped in the drunken panic that marked the defeat of the Syrian army. The purpose of the divine intervention was that Ahab would recognize God's character. And it says the lesson failed. There are two views of the Syrian horsemen. This is verse 20. One is the cavalry did not appear until later, so this refers to charioteers. The other is that the Assyrian records confirm that presence of the cavalry in the region's armies at this time, but the chariot was still the major strike force. And for 21, it states, in this verse, the horses and chariots would still more likely refer to chariotry than the mounted cavalry. It is reasonable to conclude that much of the Israelite success came from God's blessing on the surprise infantry attack on the unprepared, unharnessed chariots of the Syrian army.
God's blessing, honey. It's always God's grace. Yes, you got anything on those verses?
You got something? I find it funny. The same words that he told Ahab, don't put the cart before the horse. He should have been saying that to himself, because here you have the young ones. He said, oh, take them alive, do whatever. And they wind up slaying his men to the point where he done ran and fled. Can't get too confident. You know, he was overconfident in what he had going on, but it don't matter whether you have all the money in the world, all the glory, all the accolades, all anything, if God is not in it, it's like filthy rags regardless. You know, it's funny to me, because he should have heeded his own advice. And sometimes we're able to give other advice but not take it ourselves.
And that's when you're cocky.
Mm-hmm.
You get very cocky and overconfident. And we see that Benadad came onto the scene overconfident. Minister, would you read verse 13:22, please?
It says, God defeated the Aramean army for Ahab so that Ahab would know that God alone is the Lord. Mm-hmm. Despite this great victory and the one to follow on the plains, Ahab continued to rule without serving God. Mm-hmm. Evidence of God's greatness surrounds us, but like Ahab, we can choose to ignore it and go our own way. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But when we do, as with this evil king of Israel, disaster will strike. Open your eyes to the evidence, the victories that God is winning for you. Then rededicate yourself to him.
Mm-hmm. See what I keep telling you about Ahab? Ahab was wishy-washy, but Ahab was a man, for my view, he believed in self.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he was into self. But God will work it out for his good and for the Israelite people. He is the one that stepped in and won that battle for us. And this is why he's telling you, strengthen yourself, get yourself together, because they will be coming back. And we see the next one is fighting in the plain. So God has put us that he knows our ending before our beginning.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Amen. You have anything else on those verses, everybody? Amen. We'll keep going on today. Fighting in the plain. 1 Kings chapter 20, picking up at verse 23-27. Minister.
Amen. And the servants of the king of Syria said unto him, their gods are gods of the hills. Therefore they were stronger than we. But let us fight against them in the plain, and surely we shall be stronger than they. And do this thing, take the kings away, every man out of his place, and put captains in their rooms. And number thee an army like the army that thou hast lost, horse for horse, and chariot for chariot, and we will fight against them in the plain, and surely we shall be stronger than they. And he hearkened unto their voice and did so. And it came to pass at the return of the year that Ben-Hadad numbered the Syrians and went up to the Aphek to fight against Israel. And the children of Israel were numbered and were all present and went against them. And the children of Israel pitched before them like two little flocks of kids, but the Syrians filled the country.
And that's what he was telling them, stripping yourself because they're coming back. Mm-hmm. Let's just go to the commentary and see what they're saying here.
Amen. 23:25 it says, the Syrians then prepared for battle in the following year, most likely in the spring, the usual time for war. They assumed that their mobile forces would be more effective in the plain instead of the mountains. But the reorganization of the Syrian chariots may have been disastrous. A feudal system in which regional kings provided the chariots was replaced by one in which central government officials maintained the chariots. In the long range, this was an advantage, but in the short range, it may have replaced battle-tested nobility with less experienced government captains. And for 26, it reads, the armies mobilized in the plains near Aphek in Bashan.
Would you speak 23 out of the other commentary there? That's interesting.
It says, since the days of Joshua, Israel's soldiers had a reputation for being superior fighters in the hills, but ineffective in the open plains and valleys because they did not use chariots in battle. Horse-drawn chariots, useless in hilly terrain and dense forest, could easily run down great numbers of foot soldiers on the plain. When Ben-Hadad's officers did not understand was that God, not chariots, made the difference in battle.
Mm-hmm. That's why the servants was advising him to go to the plains, fight them out there where it's open field. They don't have chariots like we have, so we can just cut them down. But what is it? Oh, that was in Gideon. They wasn't fighting man's battle, but he said he's fighting with the arm of the Lord. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So this is what was happening here. The prophet told them what to do, and they were fighting with God's strength, the arm of the Lord.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, it reminds me, Isaiah chapter 54, verse 17, and it states, no weapon that is formed against thee shall prosper, and every tongue that shall rise against thee in judgment thou shalt condemn. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their righteousness is of me, saith the Lord. So when you're fighting for the Lord, he's going to make sure whatever it is going to come to pass, because at the end of the day, our light is shining so that we can draw all men unto him. That's the mm-hmm. ultimate end. So in everything, everyone's going to learn their lesson. You know, Ben-Hadad is learning who God truly is through these Israelites that he has counted out as weak, but not knowing their strength is in the Lord, their heritage is in the Lord.
So he also said that God wanted Ahab to know who God was as well.
Yep, exactly. Everybody's going to learn. That's what I was just saying. Everybody's going to learn in the situation. God's going to work it all towards his good, you know. Mm-hmm. No matter what side you are.
My commentary here said that the idea of a localized deity was predominant in the ancient world, and they felt that a particular god has authority over particular areas, because the recent victory was won on the hilly terrain. The servants of the king of Syria believed that the God of Israel was a localized deity with power over the hills and not the plains. It says, many today think that God is the God of hills, not of plains. They think God is a God of the past, but not of the present. They think God is a God of a few special favorites, but not a God of all his people. They think that God is a God of one kind of trial, but not a God of another kind of trial, depending upon it. Since Satan could not kill the church by roaring at her like a lion, he is now trying to crush her by hugging her like a bear. There is truth in this, but it is not all the truth. Do you really think, my brethren, that God cannot preserve his church in a particular trial through which she is now going or passing through? Is he the God of the hills of persecution, but not the God of the valleys of prosperity? It's like you have to think, you know, how do you look at God? Mm-hmm. Is God the God, only the God of the hills of persecution? Or is he also the God of the valley of prosperity? Mm-hmm. He's the God of everything. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Will he supply all of your needs according to his riches and glory?
Do you believe that?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Do you believe that what he's done for others, he can do for you?
Yeah. Mm. You know, it's reminding me of Jesus, where it said he would have done more miracles if they had believed. You know, do you believe that he can do just what he said? Because if you don't, he said, a double-minded man don't think you're going to get anything from him. Mm-hmm. You're unstable in all your ways. And at the top of this, pastor talked about that lukewarm. We say, spit us out. So you're going to be all in and truly believe God, you got to believe. Mm-hmm. There's no way around it. Spirit and truth, you just got to believe. And today that's...
And sometimes it doesn't matter what it looks like. You're not to look. It's not what we can see all the time.
Yeah.
We put our hope and our faith in God that he will do just what he said.
He said he'll do,
and if we can't do that, it's null and void. Then they wonder, why isn't he answering? Why isn't this happening? And a lot of times he is working on your behalf, even through a lot of things that's going on with you.
That part.
He's working it out.
Yeah.
I think you mentioned before that my daughter had not gotten one problem where she was going down in one, they wouldn't have found the other. So God has a way of it's not our way, it's his way.
And it's just believe, as we always say, believe. Because look, when the pandemic hit, everybody started praying. They know, but as soon as the pandemic wore down, who praying now?
9/11, people walk around carrying the Bibles and praying and whatever. Okay, that's why I love the book of Judges. As long as things are going right for us, we're going to do our own thing. That's right. But the minute...
He's the God of the pandemic, but he's not God after the pandemic is down.
Let a bomb hit over here.
They'll be running to the basements and the floods and the churches and everything. We'll knock somebody out to get a seat. Not no more.
As long as God is, they just want him to be a microwave God, and when they holler, gimme, 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 he's supposed to just dish it out. Doesn't work that way. Blessings and curses, said Deuteronomy. Okay, the covenant with Benedict.
Reads the covenant with Benadab, verses 31 through 34. It says, and his servants said unto him, behold, now we have heard that the kings of the house of Israel are merciful kings. Let us, I pray thee,
put sackcloth on our loins and ropes upon our heads and go out to the king of Israel. Peradventure, we will save thy life. So they girded sackcloth on their loins and put ropes on their heads and came to the king of Israel and said, thy servant Ben-Hadad saith, I pray thee, let me live. And he said, is he yet alive? He is my brother. Verse 33. Now the men did diligently observe whether anything would come from him, and did hastily catch it. And they said, thy brother Ben-Hadad. Then he said, go ye, bring him. Then Ben-Hadad came forth to him, and he caused him to come up into the chariot. And Ben-Hadad said unto him, the cities which my father took from thy father, I will restore, and thou shalt make streets for thee in Damascus, as my father made in Samaria. Then said Ahab, I will send thee away with this covenant. So he made a covenant with him and sent him away. The commentary for those verses says, let's see, it just has for 34. This quick agreement made in Ahab's chariot raises puzzling questions. On the surface, it seems unlikely that the Syrians had seized and held Israelite cities since the time of Omri. But there is such we do not know. It is clear that Ben-Hadad relinquished claim to some Israelite cities and gave Ahab trading privileges in Syrian territory. Streets means marketplaces. From a human point of view, with the need to create an alliance with Damascus and anyone else who would join against the Assyrians, Ahab was politically wise and prudent in dealing gently with the defeated Syrians.
As we said before, Ahab wasn't a dumb man. He had his know-how to strategize or whatever, but he just wasn't sold out for God. Minister, would you do your commentary, please?
For 31, it says, burlap or sackcloth was a coarse cloth usually made of goat's hair and was worn as a symbol of mourning for the dead or for natural disasters. Wearing ropes around the head may have been a symbol of putting oneself at another's disposal. Ahab could have hung them if he wished. Doing this, therefore, showed submission.
Yeah, it had to show that it had to be hard for Ben-Hadad to humble himself in this instance. Mm-hmm. And it's funny how he can humble himself to man, but can't humble himself to God, because you know, you sitting here putting on sackcloth, because it goes reading the part of 30 where it says, and he fled, and he came at that end, he fled and came into the city and into the inner chamber. And once he got there in verse 31, it said, and his servants said to him, behold, now we heard that the kings of Israel are merciful kings. We heard they're merciful. So go ahead and put this on, and then perhaps, because that peradventure means perhaps, he will save thy life. So you are able to humble yourself unto a man, but you can't humble yourself unto the Almighty God. That's crazy, because that's what we do today. You know, true story. We will humble ourselves to a president, the laws, everything else, this world standards, our friends, our family, everybody else that's opposite the Lord. But we will not sit here and humble ourselves to God. It's just interesting to me. And it had to take a lot, thinking about Ben-Hadad, a lot for him to take his, put his ego aside. Because before, you just thought you had this battle in the bag.
Didn't now you think he was doing that with any sincerity? He wasn't doing that because he was serious. He was looking for a way to live. When we are on the line, when we get caught stealing, cheating, or whatever, we're going to say whatever we can to.
We'll fake that humbleness, won't
you? That cry, snot running, and everything else.
God, look at the heart. I just.
because it says there in verse 32, the latter part, Gabriel, the latter part, thy servant Benadad said, I pray thee, let me live. And that's what he was looking for. He was looking to stay alive. Mm-hmm. And if you're looking to stay alive, you're going to say whatever it is, you're going to put on that sackcloth.
Yeah.
You're going to put ashes on your face. Whatever they did back then, he was going to do. Because he wanted to look as if he was sincere.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Because that he rolled up in there bare. He was bare. They went roll up in there to clean out. And then on the second go round, out there on the plain, they were going to take them down.
Yeah.
They was going in there with all they had. The Israelites had to bow down to them. But you see, your enemies, I don't care if it's in your on your job, on your home, and your friends, family, whatever, they can come up against you. But God will protect you.
Yeah.
Whether you are 100% right. Ahab was not 100% right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But if we said God knows everything, not some. He see what's going on. Mm-hmm. If your enemies or whomever comes up against you and they're wrong, that's the weapon he's talking about.
Yeah.
That weapon may form. But as long as God is in it, it's not going to prosper.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So no, Benadad was covering his things, covering his behind. That's what he's doing.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That's he wanted to live. He wanted to live.
Mm-hmm.
And he was gonna say and do whatever he possibly could. And that shows us we do that same thing today.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Our husbands get after us because they done caught us out there, or we catch them out there, they're gonna say whatever and snots and pleading and crap, whatever it takes.
Yeah.
That's us today.
Mm-hmm.
That was them back then, but we're doing the same identical thing today.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's like I said, we're doing the same thing. Ahab wasn't right with God, Benadad wasn't right.
Yeah. Amen. That's where we're going to end it today at 1 Kings chapter 20, verse 34. We'll pick up at 35 next time. I'll turn it over back over to you, Reverend.
Amen, amen, amen. We can take a whole lot from these chapters, a whole lot to apply to our life today. You know, just look at their heart, look at what they're doing. And just see if it lines up with the word of God. And if it doesn't, run the other way.
Amen.
Minister.
Amen. I'll go back to 1 Kings 16, verse 30. When it says, and Ahab, the son of Omri, did evil in the sight of the Lord above all that were before him.
Come on.
So up to this point, he was the worst king that Israel ever had.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
and he was the worst king, but you still saw the Lord trying to intervene on his part.
He used him for his, God used him for his glory.
That's right.
Amen.
You see where, he's like that friend you used to have that, when you finally realized in the relationship, all you was doing was giving, and your friend wasn't doing anything.
Mm-hmm.
Now, because the Lord would try to, you know, intervene several times on his behalf to save Israel. Mm-hmm. And again, he still did not, you know, appreciate the relationship that God was trying to have with him, because that's the thing. God wants to have a relationship with all of us. Mm-hmm. And if you look real closely to the things you went through in your life, you can see where he intervened on your behalf, on your behest, or you may not be here today.
That's
amen.
Right.
Amen.
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 Reverend.
Read Romans 13:1. For me, this just sums up what God is saying to me, is just that
It says, let every soul be subject unto the higher powers, for there is no power but of God. The powers that be are ordained of God. Mm-hmm. So just in this today's age, you know, God knows and he sees all, and we may look at it and we see suffering, we see other stuff, but just know God's in control of it all, and there's a reason to everything. And God don't sleep nor he slumbers, so nothing can get past or by him or through him without him knowing. As he said, a sparrow can't fall from the sky without him knowing. So that's all I would say, is just, it's as the word says, blessed is the man whose hope is in the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Put your hope in that.
Pastor?
Just know that always your thoughts, your actions are going to be always favorable in God's sight.
Amen.
That's why it is so important that we have to be cognizant of what we're doing, and we have to know how to call on the Lord. And when you call on him, that's praying, as you're talking to him, and repent. Mm-hmm. Because none of us are perfect. And I heard someone say today that when you're saved, you don't sin. That's the biggest lie I ever told. I said, I know they're not too, they can quote some scripture now, but they're not too tied up in the Bible.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Because the Bible tells us, if you're saved, you don't sin, you're lying. But just know that God's word is true.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And I'll just say, who report are you going to believe, man or God? Mm-hmm. And then the other one, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good.
Yes, Lord.
And his mercy endureth forever.
Amen. Amen.
That's it.
Amen. There you have it. Let us go to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord God, for your mercy. Thank you for your goodness. Thank you, Lord God, for attending to our needs even when we don't call on you, Lord God, because you know what is best for us, you know what is good for us, and as all your children, you protect us, Lord God, even when we don't have a thought, oh God, of asking for your protection, Lord God. I thank you, Lord God, for being our rock, being our salvation, being our comforter in our every need. I ask you, Lord God, to bless those of us who are watching, Lord God. And I ask you, Lord God, to be their rock, be their shield, be their comforter as well, Lord God. And so that they will know that no matter what they're going through, God is always with them, with us, and you will never leave us or forsake us. Thank you again, Lord God, for this word, for teaching us and for our hearts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you so much for joining us, for being here with us, for studying with us, for going to the Word of God with us, because this is going to be the rock that you're going to need to stand on when the devil comes, because he's coming. So you just need to stand on this word and know that even when you don't believe you deserve it, God's going to give it to you anyhow, if that's what his will is for your life. So stand on the word of God, stand on the promises of God, and just try each day to surrender all. You're not going to be perfect, but if you try each day to surrender all, God will do the rest. Mm-hmm. Thank you for being here. Join us on Tuesday for the prayer line. Prayer changes things. We speak to God and God speaks to us. So let us armor up and pray together so Satan stronghold can be torn down. We're mm-hmm. waiting to see you. The information to get into the prayer line is scrolling across the bottom of the screen. Please go ahead and take it down so that you can know when to join us and be there with us on Tuesday nights from 7:30 to 8 p.m. Again, if this bless you, don't forget to click the like button, subscribe, and share, because the word of God needs to go out. Have a blessed evening and continue to listen and grow in the wisdom of God.
Amen. Yeah.